Imagine getting the energy needed to power our phones, light up our homes, or drive our cars from thin air. And no, we're not talking about Nikola Tesla's dream of wireless power a century ago, but a new accidentally electrifying discovery along those lines from the University of Massachusetts Amherst. Now, researchers have found a way to turn humidity into electricity. It's called hydroelectrical power, and believe it or not, a company named Cascada Chuva is already trying to commercialize a variant of the technology. So what is it, and how does it work? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This video is brought to you by Surfshark, but more on that later. We all know that there's a race to generate clean electricity in a renewable fashion. There's a lot of compelling reasons for why, from limiting climate change to saving money to energy independence. It's why getting solar panels in your home is so compelling. It's also why this news about generating electricity from the air caught my attention and got me interested to explore it. A team from the University of Massachusetts Amherst looks like they've discovered a way to convert moisture in the air from all around us into electricity, turning humidity into kind of a battery of sorts. And funnily enough, like so many other Keystone inventions over the years, it started as an accident. Now, it's also a bit of a mystery as to why it's actually working the way it does, but I'll get into that in a bit. So let's start from the beginning at UMass Amherst. Now, the story begins with Professor Jun Yao and his researchers who were trying to create a novel air humidity sensor using an array of nanostructures. Now, the student working on the project forgot to plug it in, and yet the sensor produced an electrical signal. Now, puzzled by the frankly spooky phenomena, Yao and company investigated and they discovered an interesting reaction occurring. Now, the science we're about to talk about is complex, and not even Yao or other scientists are totally sure what's taking place here. So keep in mind that what I'm about to describe isn't just an oversimplification, but an oversimplification of the researcher's best guess as to what's going on. You still with me? Okay, the nanostructures on the UMass sensor are 100 nanometers thick, which is less than 1/1000th of the diameter of a human hair. This makes them just wide enough for the airborne water molecules to freely enter, but also makes it difficult for them to pass all the way through. And though the exact mechanism is not well understood, the researchers think that every time the water molecules knock against the tiny hole's edges, it creates an electrical charge via a process called deprotonation. Because there's more molecules moshing around in the easier to access top of the tube than the bottom, we get an electric imbalance between the layered chambers and end up with positively and negatively charged ends like a battery. Now, with no moving parts, it functions a lot like a solid-state battery. Yao and his team then began to iterate, punching a bunch of 100 nanometer or less pores into all sorts of stuff, from graphene oxide flakes to polymers and wooden nanofibers. They even tried using bacteria to grow protein nanowires. In the end, all of these attempts were successful, which is really exciting. These results suggest that the size of the nanostructures matters more than what they're made of, which could well mean that some team will find an even more potent material down the line. But that does beg the question, just how much electricity can the UMass generic AirGen effect device create? Well, presently, it's not much. The device produces roughly a single microwatt, which is just enough to power one pixel on an LED screen. But the device is very small, just the size of a thumbnail and 1/5 the width of a human hair. In theory, if we connect several of these devices together, or dozens or hundreds of these things together, we could power something much more substantial just by borrowing a little more moisture from the air, which is pretty amazing. And that premise is what a Portuguese company called Cascada Chuva is based on, promising to commercialize their version of the AirGen device with a pilot in 2024. But there's a whole lot of giant question marks there. But before we get into the details of commercialization, it's important to note how hydroelectrical power has theoretical advantages over other renewables. I mean, have you ever tried to fit a wind turbine or hydroelectric dam next to your garage? Kidding aside, if you're somewhere that doesn't get a lot of sun, or if you live in an apartment and don't have enough space, or if you rent and your landlord is against it, solar panels might not be accessible to you. But if things go right for Cascada Chuva, and that's a big, big if, the company claims that you can take home a decently powerful humidity battery about the size of a washing machine, something most people can easily find room for. And unlike those other renewable energy sources, you can in fact use a humidity battery inside your home as long as the specific humidity is high enough. The specific humidity, which is the meteorological property that governs how many water molecules are in the air, will vary independently of daytime cycles. At least some of the time, there will be plenty of specific humidity when the wind isn't blowing and the sun isn't shining, and this makes it a good potential teammate for more common yet intermittent renewables like wind and solar. And though the tech might sound too good to be true, Again, it's really early days here. It isn't a one-off discovery. Researchers from Tsinghua University are experimenting with hydroelectric films that can generate almost 1.5 volts. And researchers from the Beijing Institute of Technology are experimenting with hydroelectric powered wearables. So though we may not totally understand what's going on, we're making enough headway in the field to conclude that something is happening here. And that's what got me excited about this. We're seeing some interesting steps forward on a new potential technology. But what about the costs? Now, before we get to the costs and other challenges, there's something else that doesn't cost that much that can help you online, and that's today's sponsor, Surfshark. I always recommend using a VPN when using public Wi-Fi, but VPNs can be very useful even when you're at home. A lot of online services use some pretty sophisticated commercial tracking and machine learning to apply very targeted advertising, and a VPN can protect you from some of that. Surfshark's clean web does a great job blocking ads, trackers, and malicious websites, making it safer to use the internet even at home. And you can even make it look like your IP address is coming from a completely different country. This can come in handy if you want to stream a video that's only available from a specific location. I used this exact feature on a trip I just took to Vancouver, and it was fantastic. And one of the best parts of Surfshark is that it's easy to set up on all of your devices, whether that's iPhone or Android, Mac or PC. Surfshark is the only VPN to offer one account to use with an unlimited number of devices. Use my code to get 3 extra months for free. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself. Link in the description below, and thanks to Surfshark and to all of you for supporting the channel. So, back to the costs. Now, while we still don't fully understand the mechanics at play in the AirGen device, the outlook is positive enough that Cascada Chuva is reportedly close to commercializing their own humidity battery. Their device, which is just 4 centimeters or 1.5 inches wide, can currently power an LED light. Now, the plan, according to co-founder and CEO Andriy Lubchik, who's been working on this since 2015, is to stack 20,000 of these devices together by 2024. Now, the company says that once combined into this washing machine-sized cube, the humidity battery can passively generate 10 kilowatt hours of electricity per day. And that's a bold claim, but per Cascada Chuva's calculations, that should cover the energy use of about 150 square meter household, not counting charging an electric car. If true, that's pretty impressive. And of course, power comes at a price, and these novel humidity batteries are not cheap. Cascada Chuva is predicting that the device's levelized cost of energy, or LCOE, which is a way to compare effectiveness of different energy generators across their lifetime, will be quite high initially. Now, consumers will hypothetically be paying 14,000 to 18,000 euros, which is about $15,000 to $19,000 US. And remember that there's a lot of factors to consider when comparing means of generating electricity. But using the US as an example, you can get a 10 kilowatt solar panel system installed for around $20,000 on average, counting for federal tax rebates and credits. So if all goes to plan, the price point is pretty comparable. Assuming the technology works and takes off, then standardization and mass production could bring those costs down over time. So you might be wondering why we should even pay attention to this tech, even though it's still in its infancy. Well, with its unique properties, an AirGen device could be the most accessible form of clean energy yet. The more viable methods of producing electricity at home, the better. After all, solar panels are great. I love mine, and I love that they lower my energy bills, and I think everyone who can use them should absolutely try them. But not everyone has resources to do so, and this is a potential alternative to get in on some of those benefits. Hypothetically speaking, AirGen devices could allow you to become energy independent in a part of the world where you find ample humid air. This could be really useful for powering portable and remote locations where power line infrastructure can't reach, or providing emergency power during outages or disasters. Of course, scaling up nano devices is notoriously difficult, but humidity batteries still have some applications, even if circumstances force them to remain small. Imagine being able to charge your phone batteries or a laptop almost anywhere. And the minuteness of the power generated may actually be beneficial on the smaller scale. That's because the mechanics of battery chemistry force us to make certain voltage steps, like 1.5 volts, 3.3 volts, meaning that some devices must include resistors to divide the voltage. In the end, that means that you lose some of the energy as heat, but using teeny batteries with hydroelectrical chemistry setups may allow us to fine-tune our power needs. If you think about it, there are a lot of low-power devices and batteries that we end up tossing because of the repetitive charge cycles wearing them out so quickly. Small wearable stuff like Fitbits or AirPods need to be recharged, but could potentially run on humidity instead. Plus, battery chemistry is often corrosive or volatile, and if AirGen devices prove durable, we could have long-lasting, recharge-anywhere, acid-free batteries. Of course, that's a very, very, very big if. Now, I don't want us to get too carried away by all the cool stuff we might be able to do with humidity batteries. So let's talk about the challenges, and there's a considerable number of them. And the biggest hurdle here is that we still have a lot to learn. This is a new technology, and while the research surrounding it so far is pretty reputable, there's still a lot of unknown unknowns. As I mentioned earlier, no one, not even Yao and the research team, are totally sure what kind of reaction is taking place here. This might be even more important than you think. If the water molecule moshing is truly what generates a charge, it has to mean that there's an electron transfer. But by the time we're dealing with individual electrons and molecules, we might just be transferring the same few electrons between the tube and the molecule, which will drastically limit our ability to meaningfully scale up the technology. And if it works like the Seebeck effect, where two different metals in contact will produce a small voltage, then it's likely it won't produce enough of a current to be useful and could create a corrosive environment to boot. Many Seebeck-related breakthroughs look really good on paper, but their expensive components and complex construction has drastically limited their application so far. And while Yao has fully published his team's findings, at the time of making this video, Cascada Chuva hasn't. For proprietary reasons, their tech hasn't been peer-reviewed, which should rightly make you skeptical. And furthermore, Cascada Chuva's previous research has been mainly computational. And as we all know too well, what works in theory or in cyberspace doesn't always translate to meat space. But they have been working on this for almost a decade. Now, I'll be more confident once their prototype comes out and has passed some third-party inspections. Now, the flip side of unknown unknowns is known unknowns, and there are a lot of those too. How long can this technology last? Can it be successfully scaled up? What's their lifetime and LCOE? Peter Dobson, an Oxford University professor emeritus of engineering science, is optimistic about both aerogen devices, but warns about the dangers of other particles getting lodged in the nanomaterials. There are some examples of so-called superpowered nanomaterials that have been laid low by little specks of dust. Dust can break the micro-electromechanical system sensors in your phone, for example, and solar panels can also struggle when dusty. Now, granted, it takes a fair amount of dust and dirt, but it happens. How do you stop dirt, pollen, and other schmutz from clogging the device's nanopores? How do we clean and maintain them? We don't exactly have skincare routines for batteries. There's also concerns about mass production. Sourcing the material needed for nanopores could be challenging, and manufacturing them isn't cheap or easy yet. In short, we have a lot to learn before we can get serious about commercialization. Now, that doesn't mean these challenges are insurmountable. We've seen lucky breaks, sufficient R&D, mass production, and standardization help similar pieces of technology go from sci-fi to blasé. But that also doesn't mean it's a sure thing. This is still a very new technology, so I want to avoid overhyping it. However, the larger implications of drawing electricity from the air are promising. And I've said it before and I'll say it again, there's no one-size-fits-all solution. But if aerogen works, it will be another powerful green energy tool in our belt. All because a student forgot the plug. And do you think this sounds like a promising line of research? And if there's any of you out there that work in a similar area of research and have knowledge on it, please share it with the rest of us so we can all learn in the comments. And be sure to check out my follow-up podcast, Still to Be Determined. We'll be discussing some of your feedback. And thanks to all my patrons who get ad-free versions of every single video. Your support really helps make these videos possible. I'll see you in the next one.